Remember these LEDs that I got in a mailbag a while ago? I'll put a link up there if you don't. Well, they seem to be just the thing that I was looking for. So I ordered a couple more sets. And they'll work together nicely if you string them. There's a second set strung in there. But when I string in the third set, they kind of dim down. Oh wait, that's the wrong connector. Maybe it's that one. There we go. They start dimming down a little bit, and they're drawing up to about an amp, which isn't too bad, but the third string is dimmer than the rest of them, and you notice they're actually flickering weirdly, because it's just drawing too much current through the thing, and the voltage is getting too low for them to reset properly. But that is working properly. Let's go to a different... yeah, so that's working properly. It's just this third string that's dark. But again, when I plug the sets together, they don't work right. Oh, they sort of do on that. That's a little bit dimmer. But anyways, that's the one hazard with feeding all the power in just from one end. Fortunately, at the joins in each set, there is a couple of power wires available to inject power partway along. So I'm going to do that in my installation. So I guess I should back up. I'm planning on using these as Christmas lights on the outside of the house. These lights on the inside of them, let's see if I can zoom in on one here. So each one of them, you can see in through the heat shrink actually, has the WS8211 chip in it. And then a 10 millimeter LED on it. 5-7 millimeters thereabouts, RGB LED on it. Then the whole thing is kind of encased in a plastic sleeve. And then in the back, you can sort of see that there's something in there. It's either silicone or hot glue, something like that. Anyway, that makes these things weatherproof, or at least they claim to be weatherproof. So I am going to put that to the test and rig these up on the outside of the house for the season, for the winter, and just see what happens. So, things that I have to do. Run some extra power cable to these intermediary positions. So I'm going to need some sort of a control box with power supply and controller. And then I'm going to have string 1, string 2, string 3. The data is going to go right through. And actually, on these 3-pin connectors, the power and data and ground all go through. But I'm going to have extra power coming to there from the control box, and an extra power feed coming to there from the control box. I'm going to be using a lamp cord, which is literally just the cord that you'd find on a lamp that you plug in the wall. Right now I've got it on these Wagos, but I think that is 16 gauge stranded, which is way overkill for this purpose. That can handle line voltage at several hundred watts. So I'm not too concerned about that having voltage loss. This stuff is like 18 or 20 gauge or something. You can see the difference in the wire gauge. So using this heavier stuff, I'm going to have a lot less loss, and I'll be able to inject power at a couple of points along the strips. Each of these strips, or strings I guess, is 5 meters long, with I think it said 150 LEDs in each one. I'm not going to stop and count them. But so there's that. This first chunk of cable is going to have to be long enough to get from the ground up to the eave of the house where these lights are going to go. And this controller box is going to have to be weatherproof at some level anyway. It might not have to be like submersible, but it'll have to at least deal with rain and snow. It will have to have AC power coming in, It will have to have power supplies capable of feeding these, and it'll have to have some kind of a controller. So I could use this cheap little controller that comes with most of these light strings, or if it doesn't, you can buy them for a couple of bucks on eBay. But it doesn't give you a lot of control. It's just got really shimmery, flashy things, and that doesn't pass the life acceptance factor tests. So I'm going to do it the Arduino way, or more specifically, the D1 Mini way. This is a clone of a Wemos D1 Mini. It is based on the ESP8266, the -12 version. So it's got a bunch of digital pins, one analog pin, and it's got the CH340 on the back here for the serial. It's got a voltage regulator, and it can be programmed from Arduino. So that software part, I have assigned the teenage programmer to deal with, because as you may have heard if you've been watching the channel, I suck at code and I don't find it all that interesting. I like hardware. So I'm going to do this part and he can do the part that he likes. The power supply part is going to come from three of these adjustable buck converters, which I believe are capable of up to 3 amps each. So one of them will feed the D1 Mini and feed the first string from the input of the first string, basically at this position here. Then the second one will feed just DC to the join between the first and second strip, and the third one will be feeding this position back here. So to that end, I have already started building up just a little perf board circuit board here. So what have I got here? I've got a socket for the controller chunk. I've soldered some header pins onto these guys, onto the two ins and the two outs, so that they can go into approximately those positions there, more or less. I actually have to be careful because this perf board isn't just dots, and it's not just strip board like Vero board is. It's got this weird pattern. It's sort of pretending to be a little bit like the layout of a breadboard, but not quite. I've got these three connectors on here. Now these are a little two-part connector that we've got some on some pieces of equipment at work, and I really like them, so I'm going to use them for this too. So it's just screw terminals out here, but then there's a mating plug on the board, so you can lift your wires off, screw them on here out in free air where they're not getting in the way or anything, and then just plug it onto the board like that. And if you have to pull it out for maintenance, just do that and yank that whole thing out. That's also why I am putting the D1 Mini on a socket, just in case I break it and have to pull it out and swap it out with another one. These power supplies, they've only got four connections on them. I'm putting them on header pins. If I have to get medieval to remove one to replace it, well, I will. Power is going to come in through this barrel jack and come from some kind of a power brick. A laptop power brick would work. They're typically 18 to 19 volts, so that's a lot of voltage drop. I think I have in my collection a 12-volt power brick, which should work. I mean, these things are still dropping a lot of voltage, but they're switching converters, so it shouldn't be that ugly. 5 volts, 12 volts, what do we got in here? That's the biggest one here. What's that good for? 12 volts, 3 amps. 12 volts DC, 3 amps. Okay. I think that'll work. At 5 volts, that's going to be closer to about 7 or 8 amps. Yeah, that ought to do it. If you're going to be doing this hobby, it really pays to, in actual dollars and cents, to keep your eyes out for salvageable stuff. Because, I mean, a 12-volt power brick like this, especially one with like CSA and UL approval, you know, a reasonably decent one, is going to set you back a few dollars. But this was just with a piece of equipment that was getting tossed out, so obviously grab it. You can use it for anything. So now that I've got the board size figured out and the component placement figured out, I'm just going to go ahead and chop this board down to a little bit more manageable size. And this cheap phenolic resin type board is pretty easy to cut. You just make your line and drag the knife across it a handful of times. And that goes back into the bin for a future project. And we want this to come down to 5. There, she's coming down. Good. Move on to the next one. That's the cool thing about those connections. Close enough. And now I'll just screw that onto here and carry on. Okay, I've just loaded up a test sketch, one of the ones that comes with the Neopixel library. I'm using the Adafruit Neopixel library for this one because apparently it works pretty well with the ESPs, so we'll go with that for now. Got these guys connected, power, ground, and the data. Cross your fingers. Oh, hey, look at that. It's doing its thing. That's excellent. Dare I put the other two on there? Sure, why not? Oh, nice blue. Okay, let's do this. So there's the first string connected and doing its thing. Why is the third string got blue lights on it? It's not connected to the data chain yet. Is that thing changing? Yes, it is. Okay. So now I've got all the powers connected. So I'll plug in the data and just more power for the second string, which is off to my right here. There it is. And it's doing what it should be doing. Yeah, it's kind of, so it's behaving. So now I'll plug the output of the second string into the input of the third string, which I've just got off to my left here. And it just died. Why did it just die? Experimenting time, I'll be back. Okay, I just had a loose wire. Goofy. Anyway, so here's all three strings piled together. You can see that there's one string, there's one string, there's one string. They're all sort of doing their things. There's 150 LEDs, 50 in each string. And yeah, it's doing its thing. I guess the next thing to do is put some kind of a weatherproof housing around this and get the wiring ready to go up onto the house. I sort of bundle the LED strip or LED cable along with the power wires and solder the power wires onto the power insert points, which are over here somewhere, and extend them out to those things. And then to run to the first one, like I showed there, so this is going to be the this heavy white wire, and so is this going to the between the strips. Then going from the box to the first strip, I'm going to be using this wire, which is lighter gauge. It's pretty much the same as this stuff. And there will be power on it, but I'm not expecting it to provide the majority of the current. That's going to come from this other wire, but there is going to be some current there. And of course, then the center wire, what is that, green, I guess, is going to be the signal wire. No going back now. That's the start. That's the first part of it. And the other end of this wire, I actually measured it, and this is about 15 feet of wire. I measured there's 12 feet from the eave of the house down to the ground, plus a little bit of diddling around. So 15 feet should be good, I think, I hope. I don't think this is going to be how it goes through the box, but I haven't fully come up with that yet. So for now, I'll just strip this back and punch it into this. Okay, so here is the join between the first strip and the second strip. The beginning of the strip is over that way. And here's the wires that carry on. And here is my first piece of heavier cable. Now, it's not color-coded, as you may notice, but if we're getting closer, you might be able to see that one conductor is kind of ridged and one is smooth. So I am going to arbitrarily define the ridged one as the red wire. Remember that, because if I'm swearing later, I'm going to want somebody to blame for forgetting it. So we'll put some more heat shrink on and we'll do exactly the same thing, only this time we're only soldering two wires. Not sure how I'm going to weatherproof this, or if I'm even going to bother. Probably should. Somehow. Maybe just use electrical tape. I don't know. At least with electrical tape it's reversible. And I am going to use electrical tape throughout this project, so I'm not going for underwater application here. This has just got to be what you call weather resistant. I think that ought to do. Not super pretty. And I will be using the black electrical tape again just to bundle these together along here, but I've got to go further that way down the strip and add one more of these. So, in the interim time between shots here, you can tell when time changed, when days changed here, because my drink changed. And so, in the interim, I got the first version of the code from the teenage code mine upstairs. So I'm pretty excited about this. So we plug this guy in, and we have power lights. We saw the little blue blinky light on there. We have lights. We have lots of lights. We have lights forever until there. So that's pretty exciting. Well, check this out. This is the reason why I'm using an ESP8266 baseboard, because we can do this by Wi-Fi. So let's try some of these patterns that he's got programmed into here. I don't know why he's called them what he's called them, but whatever. That's kind of cool. Maybe not Christmas lights, but it's kind of cool. Try this one. Okay, a little bit different. Wait, that's the same. Let's try. Well, that's interesting. It's not really. Okay. Well, that looks kind of cool. All right, icy blue. Sure. Red and green twinkle. Send. Okay, that says Christmas lights. Sure. Silver and gold. I think some of these are requests from the wife. That's kind of Christmassy. What else we got here? More twinkling. Okay. Etc. etc. But the other thing that he's done, which is kind of neat, pulses, and we can add some colors here. Oh, wow. Wasn't expecting that. Okay, so let's change that to a slightly different blue. Select 100 milliseconds, 4, and send custom. Oh, would you look at that? That's pretty slick. So I think he said he's got a few more refinements that he wants to put into this, maybe some other patterns and stuff, but I think that's going to work pretty well. And it's working all the way to the end of the strip. So the next challenge is a weatherproof container. So I went to Princess Auto and found this guy on sale for $10. So that seems to be a reasonable thing. And it's got a rubber gasket in the lid. So that should work. And I also picked up a couple of trailer connectors, which are intended for outdoor use. So I think I will use those to connect the box, like to connect through a hole inside of the box to the strips. And then I'm going to have to pass the cord, the AC power cord, through somehow. So I'll cut the end off that and put one of these guys on. And everything should fit inside the box quite nicely with room to spare. I think what I'm going to do is use the male connector for one set of connections and the female to the other, so that there's only one way that it can connect to the strips and I can't get it wrong. Just going to put a cable tie on the inside of this one to sort of hold them together a little bit. Those cables are long enough on the inside. The color code does look a little bit weird on that, but it makes sense to me. And that's all that's really important, isn't it? What I'm going to use is this acrylic latex caulking. It's good for indoor and outdoor. It's flexible. The reason I chose latex rather than full on normal silicone is latex is not going to off-gas ammonia like the other stuff does. And this was a little bit cheaper. So I'm literally just going to goop it on from the inside and the outside and try and fill up all the gaps between the wires. This may not be pretty, but it should do the job. While I'm waiting for that sealant to dry, I'm going to connect these onto the cables coming from the LED strips and heat shrink them and weatherproof them and get that ready. And that should get me really, really close to being done. I'm just going to check it one more time for paranoia's sake. So there aren't any shorts in there. That's good. I haven't buggered up the wiring yet. So just plug these two guys in. Hopefully I got the polarities right. Ooh, that's a little short. And now the ultimate test. That flash was a good sign. That tells me that the power supplies came on. Now I just have to wait because it doesn't display anything until it finds the Wi-Fi. Oh, look, lights. Okay, let's go over to the program, and there we go. That's excellent. Perfect. So just really a couple of housekeeping things left. I'm going to fix the board in position so that it doesn't move around. but originally I had it rotated 90 degrees, but unfortunately that put the connector of the D1 Mini right up tight against there, so I can't program it. However, now that I think about it, I guess it doesn't matter because I can just pop it out of its socket, doesn't it? Yeah, okay. I think I will put it in that way. And the other thing I'm noticing is that my latex caulking isn't sticking to the box at all. So I think I'll have to weatherproof it with hot glue, which is not ideal. But there we go. That ought to be enough to hold it. I realize that having it right on the bottom of the box makes it slightly susceptible to moisture, but I'm hoping that I don't have to worry about that. I'm not going to glue it in too much, just enough to keep it from getting into trouble. Now I'm going to spend a few minutes getting all this out of the way. Yeah, that didn't work at all. And I'll hot melt glue that, but you've seen people putting hot melt glue on things. I think I'll spare you that. And probably come back when it's time to install this. Okay, there is sort of the default program. Let's put on something a bit more garish here. Yeah, okay. That's interesting. Where's Red and Green Twinkle? Let's do that. That's pretty Christmassy. What else we got here? Silver and gold twinkle. Yeah, I mean those RGB LEDs, their white is a little bluish. That's fairly typical, but that's not bad. All in all, pretty reasonable, I think. That's kind of interesting. That's kind of neat too. Oh, I think that worked out pretty well all in all. And I mean, we're just controlling it from that tablet there, which is the same software you saw earlier. But I think that's pretty reasonable. Oh, dog's checking out what we're up to. Well, that was a fairly lengthy project. If you're paying attention, you may have noticed the drink changed several times during that. That was a total of about 4 or 5 weeks off and on of working on that project. So there was a fair bit of discontinuity and weirdness in the editing, and I apologize for that. If that caused any questions, please feel free to ask in the comments and I'll try and straighten it all out. As you noticed at the end there, I chopped off some extra length, so I got, because I didn't need the full length to get around the part of the house that I needed to, so I've got these extra ones for playing with for something or other. I'm sure I'll find a use for them. The code's going to be available at a link that I'll put down in the description. It may or may not be exactly the same code that you saw me playing with earlier, because there's been some revision changes and there's probably going to be more revision changes in the future, and I'll upload those to the Google Drive that I'm going to put that on when I do that, in case anybody cares. I don't know if you want me to go through the code. I don't really understand it either. Maybe you'll have to get the teenager to explain it, although he's pretty shy. And even shyer than me. He won't even show his hands on camera. But anyway, thanks all, as always, for watching. I really do appreciate it. Questions and comments, you know the drill. I don't have to keep saying this stuff, do I? Thanks for watching. I will talk to y'all later.